Good evening. My name is Meg Satterthwaite, and I'm one of the faculty directors of the Center for Human Rights and Global Justice here at NYU. And I'd like to welcome you to this evening's discussion. And we're going to really start with a very interesting set of reflections about one of the most important human rights bodies. And let me just situate it first in why is the Center for Human Rights and Global Justice particularly pleased to have this talk tonight. First, we're just a home for all of the human rights work at the law school and also a hub for human rights activities in other parts of NYU. And we hope to really provide resources to students, scholars, and also the practitioner community relating to human rights and global justice. So the center is also actively trying to bring human rights home, really trying to bring human rights to bear on the United States, and that means human rights within the United States, and also the United States as a government actor in relation to human rights. And so each semester, we really try to have at least one evening event that focuses on one of those elements. Last semester, we had a really engaging panel on how and whether human rights are relevant to the Black Lives Matter movement and to the larger struggle for racial justice in the United States. And this semester, we're really honored to have our own alum, Ambassador Keith Harper, who's the U.S. representative to the United Nations Human Rights Council. He is going to speak not about human rights in the U.S., but more about the role of the United States within the Human Rights Council, within the human rights world. And the history of U.S. engagement with the Council is, as you probably know, fraught. The U.S. was first reluctant to fully engage. If you think back to the Human Rights Commission, sort of all of the actors in the international community have become disenchanted with the Human Rights Commission, but all for very contradictory reasons, depending on where they stood, and that included the United States. The first several years of the existence of the Council, the U.S. really stood back and looked at failings of the Council as a sign that it should not engage fully, and that was really under the Bush administration. When President Obama came into office, he took a different view and really thought about what is the U.S. role within this system and how can we engage in a more productive manner. And so that meant really looking at the Council as a potentially a very positive body for human rights and the U.S. as playing a key and crucial role. So in 2010, President Obama appointed an ambassador to the Council. And the point was not just to hopefully get elected onto the Council, but then also find this positive role for the U.S. and a positive role for the Council itself. And tonight we're going to hear from someone who's really been on the front lines of that engagement. Ambassador Harper, who has served as a U.S. representative since 2014, will be reflecting on what has the U.S. achieved, what has the Council achieved, and maybe a couple of questions that we might hope he would engage with. And he has said he'll talk for about 30 minutes, so that means there's going to be a long period for Q&A. So have some questions waiting. As you can see, also, if you want to tweet questions, we can take them that way as well. So a couple questions. Can the new embrace by the U.S. of the Human Rights Council be a sign that the U.S. takes U.N. human rights mechanisms more seriously? Or as a sign that it takes more those mechanisms more seriously also as they relate to the U.S. How does the U.S. assess the recent successes and failures of the Council? What is its role, and what role could it and is it playing now? And specifically, let's think about today's crises, Syria, Burundi, the migrant crisis. What's the assessment of how the Council is doing there? How about the universal periodic review process? Is it a success on the whole? What are its failings? How does the U.S. see the special mandates? Have they played their role? Are they largely effective, ineffective? How are they doing? So I'm about to turn this over to Ambassador Harper, but I'd just like to introduce him briefly. He's the first Native American of a federally recognized tribe to be appointed and confirmed as a United States ambassador. Nominated by President Obama, he was confirmed by the Senate on June 4th, 2014.
I have great respect for anyone who is confirmed by the U.S. Senate. Prior to his appointment, Ambassador Harper was a partner at the law firm of Kilpatrick, Townsend, and Stockton, where he was the chair of the Native American Practice Group. From 2007 to 2008, he served as a justice on the Supreme Court of the Porch Band of Creek Indians, and from 2001 to 2007 was an appellate justice on the Mashantucket Pequot Tribal Court. So we could call you ambassador and judge, actually. While senior staff attorney for the Native American Rights Fund from 1995 to 2006, his work on the Cobell v. Salazar class action lawsuit resulted in a $3.4 billion settlement in 2009. Ambassador Harper's academic positions have included an adjunct professor at Catholic University and professorial lecturer at American University's Washington College of Law. He served as law clerk to Honorable Lawrence Pierce of the Second Circuit and began his career as a litigation associate with Davis Polk. And I will repeat again, he is an alum of NYU School of Law. Ambassador Harper.
Well, first, thank you, Professor Satterwhite and the Center for Global Rights and Justice. It's really good to be back at NYU. It looks a little different. I don't think this building was here when I was going to school here. But I'm very grateful to NYU. You know, they took a kid who cared mostly about skating and surfing from California and sort of gave me the tools to do what I care about. And I've cared about two things. I've cared about many things, but two things that I wanted to focus on. One was on rights of indigenous peoples in the United States, tribal rights, and had the opportunity to litigate on behalf of tribes for a couple decades, and now the second interest of working on human rights issues in the international arena. So I very much appreciate the ability to come back here today and share some thoughts with you on the Human Rights Council and the role of the United States at the Human Rights Council. I do want to start and back up a little bit to put this in sort of the correct perspective. We oftentimes think about human rights as these concepts that have always been there. And what we have to recognize is this is a 70-year-old conversation. Yes, people were talking about it before then, but it was really in the aftermath of the Second World War that these constructs began to crystallize into institutions and into documents, and ultimately into legally binding obligations, treaties, with, of course, most critically, the ICCPR. But right after the Second World War, because of the horrors of the Second World War, there was a need felt worldwide for an additional emphasis on human rights. And so, among other things, and there was the creation of the United Nations, and as part of it, the Commission on Human Rights. And the Commission on Human Rights had extraordinary early success. It formed a drafting committee led by Eleanor Roosevelt, who was the U.S. representative to the commission. And it ultimately drafted and later adopted the Universal Declaration on Human Rights, which is still considered today the seminal document laying out rights. And most other treaties, most other instruments, particularly treaties since then, are articulations of a deeper level of the principles enunciated within the Universal Declaration. But after that point, the Commission's had some success in defining some of these norms to a greater degree. But over the years, I'm going to kind of skip forward a little bit, increasingly it became an organ that was widely viewed as highly politicized and ineffective. And by the late 1990s, early 2000s, civil society, states, pretty much everybody felt that it was a failed institution. Many states were joining the council simply to defend their own records. And increasingly, it became a council which failed at its central purpose of promoting and protecting human rights around the world. And so there was a need, particularly as articulated by then Secretary General Kofi Annan, to reinvent it, that human rights were too important not to get right. And out of that conversation came what is now called the Human Rights Council. The council has, there was a lot of thought put into the council, and there are some important innovations. The first one is, as was mentioned briefly, the Universal Periodic Review. If you look at, and I don't think it's overstatement to say this, if you look at instruments that have led to actual changes on the ground that actually impact people from a human rights framework, the UPR has been the single most important innovation in the last 40 years. Treaty bodies serve a purpose. They have created some important changes. But the UPR, which is based on the concept all three words are important, right? Universal, every state goes through it, periodic, every few years, and it's a review. Now see, the problem, one of the problems with the commission is that any time a country was on the docket, was on the agenda of the commission, it was sort of a scarlet letter. No matter whether you had political will or you didn't have political will, whether your human rights problems were caused because you were doing it or because you just didn't have the institutional capacity or what have you, it didn't really matter. If you were on the docket, it was a scarlet letter, so nobody wanted to be on the docket. The notion of the UPR is that it's universal. So the United States goes through the review, China goes through the review, Russia goes through the review, the UK goes through the review, so does North Korea, so does Syria. Everybody goes through this review. And the notion is that other states give you recommendations. They identify those things that are wrong and where you can do better, the challenges that you might be facing from their perspective, and then they ask you to accept their recommendation. And then you go through a process of accepting recommendations and then implementing them over, hopefully prior to the next review. And it sounds pretty simple, but the crazy thing is that it actually works. That if you look at changes on the ground, now look, it doesn't work with perfection. It doesn't work in all cases. North Korea hasn't changed fundamentally. It hasn't changed even significantly. It really hasn't changed at all, frankly. But they've gone through the UPR. So it doesn't work in every case because you need political will. That's this essential ingredient for the UPR to work. If you take it in good faith, it can drive a dialogue domestically. And so that was a key innovation, was the Universal Periodic Review. There was 10 agenda items created for the council. I'll talk about those in a minute. The council, instead of meeting once a year, would meet three times a year for a four-week session and then two three-week sessions. And it also had the ability to call for special sessions. So when situations arise that are particularly grave and we can't wait for another session, then you call a special session. The United States just led an effort to call a special session on Burundi in December. And we were successful in calling for the session and passing unanimously, without a vote, so by consensus, a resolution creating a mechanism to investigate the human rights abuses in Burundi. 47 members of the council, they're elected by the General Assembly. They're divided into regional groupings. So there's 13 members from Africa. There's 13 members from Asia. There are members from WEOG, that's the group the United States is in, Western Europe and other group, generally considered the West. When people talk about in the international community the West, they mean WEOG. And then there's the Eastern European group and what's called the GRULAX, which is the Latin American group. And each has a certain set number of states that they elect to the council. Importantly, the council's founding document included provisions that require that you have to have a good human rights record to be on the council. But as we've seen and we should talk about, that has been honored more in the breach than not. Trying to figure out ways to do better on that is a constant effort in our mission in Geneva. Of the 10 agenda items, there are some that are particularly important and some that are highly controversial. The one that is the most important, because I think the thing that the international human rights system has to do is where you have severe, gross, and systematic human rights violations, then it is imperative that the Council take action. Now, the Council can take action in two ways with these country-specific resolutions. Actually, there's now a third way, but the two original ways were what's called item four. We call the agendas item by item numbers, item four and item 10. Item 10 is called technical assistance. When is that appropriate? That's appropriate where a country, where the UPR is not going to be sufficient, and because a country has a more severe human rights situation. But it's a country that has political will. So it wants to do better. Where does this happen? Look at Central African Republic, which I think is a very important example. You know, Central African Republic simply doesn't have police. They don't have court systems of any, they have things that they call police and court systems, but they don't have a sufficient infrastructure of a judiciary, of a legal system, of a criminal justice system, so they can't stop the reprisal killings that are going on. They may want to. Their state seems engaged in doing it, but they simply don't have the capacity to do so. Another good example would be Cote d'Ivoire. In 2010, Cote d'Ivoire went through, of course, a political crisis. but what they showed after that political crisis is real will to put themselves on the path that they were on prior to that crisis. And that contradistinguishes them. They contradistinguish themselves from others, you know, there or elsewhere, like North Korea or Iran or Eritrea or South Sudan or now Burundi, where states do not have political will. And for those countries, then the item number is called item four. And that's when you have a more condemnatory approach, where you're being highly critical of the government and you're setting up investigatory mechanisms to determine who is doing the human rights violations, who should we hold accountable, what steps do they need to take. And these can offer an opportunity to push states in the right direction. And we'll go through some specific examples on that. The highly controversial item number is called item seven. Item seven is on the state of Israel, and specifically with respect to Palestinians. It's controversial for this important reason. It is the only state that is sort of selectively has its own agenda item. The United States position, my personal position, is that no country in the world, not the United States, not Israel, no country should be free from scrutiny. And that's why we participate so robustly in the Universal Periodic Review, in the treaty bodies, because nobody is beyond scrutiny. But so too, nobody should be treated unfairly. No country should be treated unfairly. And if you take a country and you put it on a separate agenda item and treat it differently from every other country, no matter what the human rights violations are, then that's a problem for us. And so we are opposed to all item seven resolutions. We don't even look at the text, so to speak. We're going to be opposed because of that. And there's a reason for it. There's a reason why that Israel is treated differently, and that's because there's an attempt to delegitimize the state of Israel. And the United States takes a strong position on defending Israel from that. Not, again, not that any country is free from scrutiny. We get this question a lot about why we defend Israel on this, because sometimes the vote is 46-1, and we're the one vote, and it's because we take this principled position on it. Because of item seven, and because of the perception that the Human Rights Council was going to be just like the Commission on Human Rights, the Bush administration made a decision not to engage at the Council. or have limited engagement, not seek a seat. And then ultimately, they didn't engage at all. And so without U.S. leadership at the council, there were hardly any country-specific resolutions. There were a few country-specific resolutions that were holdovers from the commission that continued, but the vast majority of them did not. There was an extraordinary hyper-focus on Israel, all of which simply confirmed the biggest critics' understanding of what the council was going to be. And so in 2000, as mentioned, in 2009, President Obama said that he would engage at the Human Rights Council, that our engagement would make a difference, and that our engagement would change the way the council works, that we would have the ability to work with our partners around the world and change the direction of the council. And I think the record makes clear that he was right. You know, we're going through an election right now, and depending on how that election comes out, there will be a relitigation of this issue potentially as to whether or not we should engage at the Human Rights Council. From my standpoint, I don't begrudge that conversation. I think that conversation of what how we make policy decisions in the United States is always a good thing. We should relitigate a lot of things often. And it actually is it's a important demonstration of the health of our political system that we can have these conversations and we do reassess. It's why we're able to have self-correction. You know, I'll give you an example of self-correction that has to do with the treaty bodies. As you know, in the Bush administration, they gave certain interpretations of the Convention Against Torture. That excluded certain actions that occurred in certain places. And we had an opportunity to be before the Committee Against Torture that reviews every state that is a party to the convention they do a general review of each state. But the question we knew we were going to have to answer is, do you agree with the Bush administration's views on torture? Now, if anybody's been following this, they should know that torture is something President Obama cares deeply about. His first action in office was to outlaw all anything that could be construed as torture in anywhere around the world by U.S. By U.S. officials or those under control of the United States. And so, but there's the one thing to say that you're against and you're taking a different approach. It's quite another thing to say you reject these legal interpretations, because that takes a process. But now we're going before the committee and we had to decide which way we were going to come out. And we had about a year-long process and then announced in November of 2014 that that torture is illegal at all times and all places without exceptions. So this is the kind of thing in which the U.S. tries to lead by example, because when we, who most of the world sees, even when they say they don't, as an important example of supporting human rights, when we are prepared to go under the scrutiny of the world or these treaty bodies, then that sends a signal to others that they shouldn't be afraid of it either, even though they don't have the institutions, even though they don't have the self-correcting mechanisms as we have here. Often, when we have questions of this nature as to whether to engage in a body, the record is messy, right? Think about it in 2006. You had the Commission on Human Rights, terrible record, but this is a new thing. But we still had item 7, but you also had an item 4, which we very much supported. It's a messy record. We don't know how it's going to work out, whether or not it's going to be a successful institution or not. We are in the advantageous position now of not having such a messy record. We have 4 years when the United States did not engage on the council, and we have 6 years when the United States sought, had membership on the council, and served as one of the council members, and pursued an agenda working with our partners. You can compare and contrast. What are the results? Now, the first thing you have to do when it's making this kind of assessment, seems to me, is ask yourself, what is your measuring stick? What is your barometer? How do you judge something is successful or not in one place or another? I look at two things that I think are the right measuring stick, and they conflate into one thing at the end of the day, and I'll explain that why. The first is, does the institution protect and promote human rights around the world? Because that's what the institution is supposed to do. So if it's achieving that objective, then it seems to me it's doing something important. The second thing that I would say is it furthering U.S. foreign policy? Now, the reason those are conflated is because the president has said repeatedly that human rights is the cornerstone of American foreign policy. Because we fundamentally believe that you create a more prosperous and more secure world by abiding by human rights norms, that the more countries abide by human rights norms, the more prosperous, the more secure, the more safe we all will be. And that's good for America, and that's good for the world. And that's why it's a cornerstone of foreign policy. This is a clean record. We can simply say, what did we produce in those 4 years, and what did we produce in these 6 years? Let's talk about that. Again, in the 4 years, there were no new country-specific resolutions, none. There were many resolutions on Israel, and there were 6 special sessions. Now, this, again, is when the situation is so grave that you have to have a special meeting before the next council session, that waiting till the next council session would be insufficient because irreparable harm could occur between now and then. So there were 6 special sessions on Israel. There was one other special session in that time period. So 4 years. Since the United States engaged on the council, there's been 2 special sessions on Israel. So for those who say that this hyper focus on Israel is the reason that we should not engage at the council, well, when we engage, you only have 2 special sessions in 6 years, and when we don't engage, you have 6 special sessions in 4 years. The argument makes little sense. More importantly, or equally importantly, there is also a much greater focus on country-specific resolutions since the United States joined. Let me run through some really key examples. The first one I'll talk about is North Korea. We were able to run a resolution working with our partners working especially with the EU and Japan on the DPRK. Not only that, in 2013, the Council passed a resolution that established what is called a Commission of Inquiry. One of the important roles of the Council is to create mandates. This is experts in international human rights law or international humanitarian law who will go out and investigate a particular situation or a particular theme, a particular subject area. So you have special rapporteurs, commissions of inquiry, you have independent experts, you have a whole variety of tools. The heaviest medicine, the one that's seen as most condemnatory, is a commission of inquiry. And this is where you appoint a handful of people, anywhere between 3 and 6, and they go down and do a deep dive assessment of the human rights situation in the country. And so this commission went out, and they weren't able to get cooperation with North Korea, so they had to do their reporting through interviews in Japan and Korea and other places, in South Korea and other places. And they came up with a report a year later on the human rights situation in North Korea, detailing with great specificity and using the victims' voices about all the human rights violations, things like 3-year-olds thrown in prison because their father escaped to South Korea, along with their grandfather. And these prisons are not, I mean, prison is bad enough, but we're talking about prisons with hard labor where people often starve to death. Literally no freedom of expression or freedom of association in some way. None of the fundamental freedoms that we would have. We have been saying these things for many, many years. If you look at the United States human rights reports on North Korea, we have said this for many, many years. Japan has said it, the EU has said it, others have said it. But there is a fundamental difference when a UN report with a UN imprimatur documents with such great specificity all of these crimes, all of these abuses, and says that there may be crimes against humanity. It fundamentally shifts the conversation. In the September session of the Human Rights Council and in prior sessions, we had a conversation about North Korea. This is, of course, after the report was issued. China used to say, prior to this Commission of Inquiry report, that, you know, this is not, the situation isn't nearly as bad as those imperialists are saying, you know, those Americans and their allies. It's not that bad. And that Russia would say the same, and some other countries, Cuba, Venezuela, would say the same. But now, they don't argue that way. They don't assert that the facts are wrong. We're not arguing whether North Korea has a human rights problem. Now their criticism is how to solve that human rights problem. Now that may not sound like a big deal, but that is a huge deal. That is a huge deal because we're now focused on addressing the issue. And that has isolated their biggest defenders. And that's why we're able to get a General Assembly resolution through that asks the Security Council to look at international justice systems. That's how we're able to get the Security Council to put this on their agenda. These things often take far longer than we'd like. If you look at apartheid South Africa, if you look at Myanmar, if you look at these things around the world, they often take far longer than we'd like. But what we know is that this kind of international scrutiny and pressure does work and can work, coupled with other things like sanctions and economic isolation. Another good example is we ran a resolution, and we have run a resolution every year on Iran. And really the only good reporting coming out on the human rights situation on Iran is coming out of the Special Rapporteur's reports. And it's showing that despite the things Iran is saying, despite the things Rouhani has articulated about their new look on human rights, that they're actually declining, that they're executing more people for more different crimes, that they're actually oppressing minority religions to a far greater degree. And so this reporting allows us to have this debate based on facts, with the UN having an imprimatur on it that gives it a greater level of credibility. Belarus, another case that fell off the council's agenda when it went from commission to council, back on the agenda, reporting out of Belarus. Syria, perhaps the most important example other than Sri Lanka. In Syria, of course, we had this utter disaster, humanitarian crisis, human rights violations across the board, and this goes to the Security Council, and the Security Council fails to take action because Russia is blocking. Now, we don't have the tool the Security Council has, we should be quite clear. I mean, our ability is to shine a light on bad actors, but we do know that shining a light on bad actors tends to have the impact of them not wanting to do their bad acts as much. It doesn't always work, but we know that they like to operate in the dark. And it can lead to set the factual predicate for ultimate accountability. In Syria, that resolution was critical to persuading many of the illegitimacy of the continuing of the Assad regime. And that changed the conversation in the international community as well. We also have resolutions on Eritrea. We have a resolution on South Sudan that the United States led, and Sudan. There are a lot of countries that are prepared to go with us when we are at the table, but we have to take the leadership role. And that is just the realities of the multilateral system. And so when we're absent, those things don't get done. But when we're there, we can pursue these key objectives. I do want to spend a moment on Sri Lanka because I think this is an example where you are actually seeing changes on the ground that are fairly dramatic and in a fairly short time period, and largely by actions on the Human Rights Council. As many of you may know, in Sri Lanka there was a conflict for a number of decades between the government of Sri Lanka and a terrorist organization called the LTTE, nicknamed the Tamil Tigers. Now, I am not in any way saying that Tamils in Sri Lanka do not have some important grievances that are longstanding, but the LTTE was a terrorist organization, let's be quite clear. They bombed politicians in India and in Sri Lanka. They created the suicide bomb that the world still enjoys today, with it having been adopted by so many other terrorists. So this was a fight in which we wanted Sri Lanka to prevail. But what happened is at the end of that conflict, they decided that they were just going to kill everybody. Well, maybe that's not entirely fair, but they didn't care if a lot of civilians died. And a lot of civilians did die. And there were grave human rights abuses across the board. Sexual violence, killing, extrajudicial killing of civilians, et cetera, all the things that we're seeing now, torture, all the things we're now seeing in Syria. So the council initially passed a resolution that was complementary of the Rajapaksa regime, much to the dismay of the United States and a number of others. We subsequently passed another resolution that was more in line with condemning Sri Lanka for failing to have any accountability mechanism despite these widespread abuses of Tamils and Muslims as well. At the same time, Rajapaksa was closing up civil society space, arresting journalists and opposition leaders, and basically Sri Lanka was heading in a very bad direction. We ran a resolution, the United States ran a resolution with key partners in March of 2014. And that resolution became a central feature of the conversation of the politics in Sri Lanka. And it ended up that a guy named Sirisena, who was in the party with Rajapaksa, ran against the president. And he ran on two issues. He ran on anti-corruption, and he ran on re-engagement with the international community, citing as his principal piece of evidence the Human Rights Council resolution, which created an investigatory mechanism that was going to investigate the end of the LTTE conflict and other human rights abuses. And Sirisena subsequently came into office. He freed up Tamil lands and gave it back, widespread allowance of fundamental freedoms like freedom of expression, freedom of association, let many political prisoners out of jail. Look, this is, Sri Lanka's at the beginning stage of a long process, but this is and these things are always two steps forward, one step back, but they were on a trajectory towards far greater autocracy, and now they're in a trajectory of laying down the foundations of a better Sri Lanka through accountability and reconciliation. It's a fundamental shift on the ground in Sri Lanka and due in large part to the actions of the Human Rights Council. There's a number of other areas that countries like Libya and Burundi that are also key. There's things on the thematic side like the United States pursuing the Freedom of Expression Resolution and the Freedom of Association Assembly Resolution. There's the Internet Freedom Resolution, establishing the principle. These are all resolutions that have gone by consensus. China votes in favor of these. And they have to because they don't want it to be seen as voting against freedom of expression, even though they deny widely freedom of expression in their country. Internet freedom stands for the proposition that what is free offline should also be free online. This was a debate. And the Internet Freedom Resolution answered that debate, an important answer to an important question. We ran a couple of years ago with partners from the Latin American states. They ran, but with our support, a resolution on the discrimination and violence against LGBTI persons. It's called generally the SOGI resolution, Sexual Orientation and Gender Identity. And that subsequently ran last September with a vote of 25-14. Now, this is a hot debate in the international community, you know, what to do with LGBTI issues. We obviously are heavily supportive of robust protections. But the fact that we're able to get this resolution passed with a significant margin is a testament to our ability to get key foreign policy objectives met when we're engaged. In my judgment, when we relitigate these issues, as we will, we'll do that soon, and if not soon, we will do that at some point. We ought to litigate them based on the facts, based on the record. And the record here could not be more clear that the world is better off, the Human Rights Council is better off, and the United States is better off if the United States engages with this body and other multilateral forums. I will end it there. Thank you.
Great, so now we are going to just really open up the floor. Thank you so much for your remarks. And what I would ask is if you could raise your hand, and then when you do speak, if you can push the speak button on your microphone, and when you cease speaking, push it again so that it goes off.
Thank you, Ambassador Harper. You threw out a statement in the beginning in relation to the UPR being the most effective system for promoting human rights in the last 40 years. And I was wondering if we can tease out one element of it, which you unpacked it fairly well throughout the talk, but just to pick one thing, I was wondering if it's a specific kind of contextual statement in regards to US particularly. You'd say that it holds true for the United States more than the others. And I was wondering if one of the things within that would be how you would see the U.S.'s interaction with treaty bodies in particular and comparing it to the UPR, because there's considerable gap in what the U.S. has ratified. For example, the Child Rights Convention is not, and you feel that the strength of the UPR sort of would come, and anything you have to throw as an example which you think has been strengthened in relation to the U.S. in the UPR process. Thank you.
Thank you. That's a great question. I would start by saying that, of course, we do have a challenge in our country from time to time on ratifying treaties. We're, of course, signatories to the CRC, as you mentioned, and we have ratified the optional protocols on the CRC. So we actually do get reviewed by the committee, and, of course, their first question is, why haven't you ratified the CRC? The administration is going through an active process right now as to whether or not we should put it to the Senate for ratification. And that judgment has a political context and a legal context, and so it's not an easy call, because you certainly don't want to undermine what you're trying to accomplish. As we've seen with the Disabilities Treaty, which we thought would likely get through in light of the support, didn't. These things just have to be assessed with kind of, in a probing way. And so that's the process we're engaging in now. But look, there's a number of those treaties, CEDAW is another one, disabilities. I mean, these are core human rights treaties. What I would say is that the United States, despite whether or not we're signatories to those treaties, we support them in principle, and we try to live up to the obligations, at least for most of them. The ESC, there's some challenges on the ESC, especially in the group right context. But most of the others, the core human rights instruments, we try to live up to the provisions, whether or not we're being reviewed. But you do bring up an important thing that, under the UPR, it's soup to nuts, if you will, and you can raise whatever issue you want. The state decides what's so we get asked about the right to development, for example, that we reject as a right, even though we, of course, care deeply about development as the biggest donor country in the world. So, no, I do think the UPR offers a process. I sort of analogize it to holding a mirror to yourself. And when you take it seriously, and you act in, when you're trying to look at it in good faith, I do think it drives conversations. Now, I will say those conversations are not always visible to the public. There's some aspects of that conversation are visible. And there's a whole slew of reasons for that. I mean, deliberative process, privilege. I mean, I could go through the all kinds of reasons why governments keep those conversations, part of them internal. But those conversations do drive policy discussions. One of the things that was raised a couple of different times, first when we were under our CERD review, which was the first one that I did, which was August of last year, Committee on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination, of course, police brutality was raised, and it was raised when we were under the review of the CAT, and it was raised when we were under UPR. It's gotten raised a number of times. And not that I think, you know, the president was already going to do things. He was already prepared to take additional steps. The DOJ has taken additional steps in trying to address this issue. But when the world community, particularly key allies, are saying, we need you to address this in a way, it does have an impact on the conversation. Yes, I think even with the United States, it can be a helpful tool because we can see better how the world community sees us.
Thank you very much. I do not come from the HR community, if I use that term, but I've been an observer of the U.S. Foreign policy, sometimes as a practitioner of diplomacy, and it is clear that there have been ups and downs, and I still think that the golden era was that of Jimmy Carter, and he set a path that very quickly was abandoned because of a usual pattern by which there is a contradiction between power and ideals, and that has been very much the history of this country. the question is, what can be undo if, okay, I'm not an American citizen, so I can show my preferences because they won't matter. if a Republican is elected, none of them, except maybe for the more silent, have shown any remorse for the egregious violations of human rights during the last time their guy runs the show, and they are, on the contrary, are for muscle over everything. Maybe when they arrive do you think that there has been set a course of no reverse that might become like too much for them to renege, or on the contrary, because we have already seen that Reagan, particularly in Central America, the support of all kind of human rights violators, massive violators. Quite a few of the big guys have a happy life in Florida there. I know that some of them have already. So I think you understood the question. Thank you.
Let me start off by saying, as a caveat, I'm not going to get into sort of the political conversation that's going on right here in the country today because I'm apolitical, as I must be. I want to sort of take it out of that context. I think that there have been times when certain administrations, and I think this is one of them, the mob administration is one of them, that have put a higher premium on human rights. I think there have been certain administrations that have sometimes talked the game, but have used it as a more of a political tool, frankly. So I'm only talking about the past. I'm not going to talk about anything going forward of the particular candidates. The other thing I would say is, just as an observation, I think that we should have the conversation between those things. As you brought up the Reagan administration, those things that happened in the Cold War and after the Cold War, because I think that there's a fundamental shift that has occurred. What will continue to happen is that we will continue to relitigate these issues all the time. And I don't think that's a bad thing. I mean, I think that's a good thing. I mean, there's a book out there that talks about how the human rights system hasn't done any good over the last 7 years. I fundamentally disagree with it. I think the arguments are rather silly. But, you know, we should assess. I mean, does it really lead to a more prosperous, secure, and safe world? I think there's great evidence that it does. I mean, you take one example on prosperity of the world. Report after report, the empirical data could not be more clear on this point. To the extent that a country gets women's rights correct, to the extent that they stop violence against women, they give access to capital to women, they provide education for schoolgirls, the full panoply of rights that we put under the rubric of women's rights, where they get those rights, where they do better on those, they have set the foundation for social and economic success and political success largely. And where they fail to do so, they have completely undermined their ability to compete and to be successful and prosperous. And so when we talk about these concepts of human rights lead to X world, there is a debate that goes along with that, and that's a healthy debate. And so I don't want to discourage the debate, but what I would say is this: we should have that debate not on fanciful notions, but we should have that debate based on records, based on what happens when the United States does X instead of the United States doing Y. And this is true for our engagement at the Human Rights Council, but it's true for the way we make decisions on our foreign policy writ large. I mean, there was massive criticism of the deal regarding Iran on the nuclear agreement. Massive criticism. I mean, it was a hotly debated topic. Some people still denounce it. And we'll see whether or not it's going to create a safer world. I think it will. And then when we ask ourselves the next time around, should we have an approach that seeks to resolve a problem of this nature in a diplomatic way, we can then judge what we should do based on that record. And I think that is what the discipline that we're trying to operate under, at least at this administration. I can't speak for future ones.
Good evening. I must say that your speech today was quite informative. I have a concern, and I'll be happy if my concern is addressed. Thank you. Please, I would like to know if there are set parameters or criteria upon which the United States bases its decision to take lead role in human rights protection, especially in brokering peace in conflict situations where human rights are likely to be infringed upon. And also, are there specific programs put in place to forestall conflict, especially in places like Nigeria and other countries in Africa? Thank you.
You know, the first question is a question we think about a lot and we discuss a lot, and we should discuss a lot. because it's an important question of what role the United States should play and when it should play it. And I think that the lesson learned from Rwanda was that when you see the signs, and you usually can see the signs, where something may happen that's awful, that's going to be something of that nature as happened in Rwanda, then somebody has to take action. And usually we're going to have to lead on that. And so, for example, with respect to Burundi, which is, you know, I'm not comparing the two in the sense of, I don't think Burundi is the next Rwanda. I'm not saying that. But I'm saying that we're seeing signs of a, not only a growing crisis, but a growing humanitarian situation and a growing sense that this is kind of spiraling out of control. And that the political conflict, as the High Commissioner Zeid Al-Hussein has said, has moved from a purely political conflict to one with ethnic overtones. And we know, particularly in that part of the world, that could be very dangerous for the country that's 85% Hutu and 15% Tutsi. So we're trying to use all our tools, whether it's at the Security Council, through bilateral relationships, or with the Human Rights Council, to see what we can do on Burundi. And so that our emphasis now has been to try to stabilize the situation, work with our partners in the AU. They've tried to send a 5,000-man contingency to Burundi. Burundi has said no to that, so we're reassessing other avenues. The Security Council last week, Samantha Power, our ambassador here, went out to Burundi along with other Security Council members. So, you know, we think that when you have growing crisis, then the international community should act. And that's why we tried to act in South Sudan, and that's why we tried to act in Sudan, and that's why we tried to act in now in Burundi. I think there'll be future countries, not just in Africa. I mean, look at, you know, the steps we've taken for many years regarding Myanmar. So we're sort of in the unenviable position of sort of damned if you do and damned if you don't, you know, that there are many countries, there are many stakeholders, there are many NGOs on various sides of the political spectrum that if we don't take decisive action, criticize us for not taking decisive, why didn't you solve that problem? And if we do take action, then they blame us for taking action. Not that we're infallible. I mean, you know, we've seen that we can make some bad mistakes. I don't think anybody at this point, or not many, defend the Iraq war. So, you know, we recognize that we can't let the criticism bother us because it's going to come no matter what we do. So we try to take an effort as what can we do to help the situation? But if it moves in the direction of gross atrocities, then we think the United States has to be involved. And we've made sanctions in Burundi. We're leading efforts across the UN. I got so involved in that question. Did you have what was the other one?
Thank you. You've spoken well. Well, I still have, I still want you to please talk about, with specific reference to Nigeria, because we've been having growing crisis. I'm from Nigeria, and I have very serious concerns about what has been going on. I'm sure the whole world is aware. And many times, for the love I have for this country, the United States of America, and respect I have very tremendous respect for this country. I have very keen interest in knowing what the United States of America has done with reference to the abuses of human rights in that region of the world. It's critical, and I think maybe we can begin to look at it now.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And I think I should back up and sort of explain how we approach human rights issues, right? Because I think that people wonder and say, well, why don't you talk about this issue or that issue at the Human Rights Council? But the way we look at it is the Human Rights Council is one tool among a set of tools. And we sort of make an assessment of, and I should also say the Human Rights Council has basically a certain amount of political bandwidth. It can't take on every country in the world because we will never pass a resolution. And so you can only take on so many countries. So you really have to go for the gravest situations. Not that there aren't situations in a lot of other places that are pretty severe. So we've used efforts like the Universal Periodic Review to raise concerns. And we regularly raise concerns bilaterally, sometimes quietly, sometimes not so quietly. We try to make the assessment of which of those tools in the toolkit is most appropriate to get the best results in a particular circumstance. And that's generally how we approach any country in any human rights situation.
So thank you for giving us such a speech. And I have a maybe broad question. So you mentioned that there are two elements when we are talking about success. One is to improve human rights situation overall in the world. Second is furthering of U.S. policies. Is there any goal that the U.S. set for itself or the Human Rights Council set for itself, like in the long-term future, or like the major tasks actually focus on the current situation and in an ad hoc manner? Thank you.
Can you repeat the beginning of your question?
Yeah, I didn't catch the beginning.
Yeah. Okay, so you mentioned that there are two elements when we're talking about the success of the work of Human Rights Council. And one is about improvement of human rights in the world overall. And second is about the furthering of U.S. foreign policies. Yeah, so my question is there any like long-term goal that the U.S. set for itself, or the Human Rights Council set, or like the major task of the Human Rights Council is actually like ad hoc based. So yeah.
Yeah, no, that's a very good question. No, I think we have, you know, long-term objectives. I mean, I think one of our long-term objectives that I think we have brought to fruition, but we will continue to work on, is to have more country-specific attention, because we think that when you do that with the worst of the worst, there's a number of other countries that I would like to have more attention on. So Central Asia, for example, there's some, and you know, where they have systematic human rights abuses. So that's one area that is a long-term kind of continuing objective of the United States. The second thing I would say is on the thematic side, we are always assessing what is going to be the new opportunity. I'll give you an example. Last year, you know, we made the shift in part based on our own experience of not limiting our conversation when we're talking about terrorists to counterterrorism, sort of that kinetic counterterrorism, but to expand the conversation to talk about preventing and countering violent extremism. And the idea there is that there are tools, there are things you can do, like engage with religious leaders, engage with certain communities to bring them in so that they will be less susceptible to recruiting. This was a goal. The president had a summit last February. We had a joint statement that we read on behalf of 70 states at the Human Rights Council. We didn't read it. Albania read it. It was our initiative. We formed a core group. We ran another statement in June. And then in the September session, we ran a resolution that will have a panel discussion on human rights and preventing and countering violent extremism. So we will continue to have things like that, where we see wider issues that might have a human rights component and then kind of carry it forward. I think the other area that I would say, two other areas, is we always are looking to do more on women's issues, whether at the Human Rights Council or another example of women's issues is we've included it since 2010 in our Millennium Challenge Corporation grant as one of the indicators. So we look at countries that are looking to get not just the regular USAID grants, but these massive grants under the MCC program. And for them to get that, they have to do certain things. They have to be good on certain areas. And one of the areas that we've included is women's rights, because that sets a proper foundation. We know that if we invest dollars in you in a country like Benin, for example, who has done significant improvements regarding women's rights, they are much more likely to translate those dollars into solid development. And when a country doesn't have these preconditions, then they won't. And then I would just say LGBTI protections.
I want to follow up on that because that was one of my questions. So I actually started my human rights career on LGBT rights, trying to convince Amnesty International that it should work on LGBTI rights back in the late 80s when nobody was really working on it in the human rights community except for LGBTI persons. What do you think is the next step for the council? Is it more resolutions? Would there be a thematic mandate in the future? And kind of just to get beyond the LGBTI issue itself, what are the criteria that the U.S. sees as important for setting up a mandate like that, maybe using the LGBTI issue as an example?
So we support the creation of a mandate for LGBTI rights. Now, it's we don't run that resolution. The Latin American states run the resolution. It's important that they run it, because I think if we were to run it, we would be susceptible to very effective accusations of cultural imperialism. When another country from the Global South runs it, or a series of countries from the Global South, that argument is harder to make. And so South Africa has been important on this. Of course, they have the most protective constitution in the world on LGBTI issues, even though they don't necessarily live up to it on a day-to-day basis. The core group right now is Chile, Uruguay, Brazil, Colombia, and Argentina are members of the core group. And so I'm not sure, is it this year or is it a future year? We support the running. In fact, I would say I'm not sure how much value there is to running another resolution until we can create a mandate, because that's the next step. Because what a mandate does is it regularizes the conversation, and this conversation on LGBTI rights happens in a vacuum because it lacks information, because it lacks reporting. And so states can get away with saying things like, this doesn't happen in my country. Well, when you have regular reporting by the UN with the stamp of the UN imprimatur on it, then it's harder to make that argument. And so it's really critical that at some point we move towards a mandate holder. But part of this is working with our allies to see when that can happen.
Sarika.
Hi, thank you so much for your talk. I'm a second year student here, and my question is about last year's UPR recommendations, which discussed the Senate report. But the U.S. has yet to provide reparations for CIA secret detention and torture victims. So I was wondering how those victims are benefiting from the U.S.'s role on the Human Rights Council. And secondly, and also relatedly, it's uncontested that the U.S. has tortured. Do you believe that President Obama should apologize to victims of torture to maintain legitimacy at the Council? Thank you.
The easy questions, I see. You know what the president has said about, I mean, first of all, I would say the president's record on these issues is pretty clear. He's been forcefully against any form of torture and has taken both executive action and spoken on it repeatedly. But I think he also wants to look to the future and make sure that we don't cross the line again as a nation, a line that, as he said, violates core American principles more than anything else. And so I think he is gauging his actions. I'm not going to speak for the President of the United States, but I think he and the administration are gauging their actions to determine what's in furtherance of ensuring that we don't cross the line in the future. As to the specifics of your question, I mean, I think that There has been, people have suggested that it undermines our voice. I think that you can look at it two ways. I think that, you know, when other countries who have had situations and have taken, state actors have taken activities, done activities such as this, do they allow their independent legislative body to review classified information, reams of classified information, and do a report where critical findings are released publicly? The answer to that is no. We have the ability in this country, an enviable ability, to self-correct. We don't always do it as quickly as I think a lot would like, but we do have that capacity. And that is a capacity that not a lot of other countries have. And so, in one sense, the Senate report and the things in the Senate report, I understand the desire for us to act on it. Again, the president has said that what's most important is looking to the future. But I think we also should look at the value that we have in our system to that allows the creation of such a report.
Thank you so much for your remarks tonight, and thank you for your leadership at the Human Rights Council. As you said earlier, the U.S. role on Sri Lanka is unquestionable. Since 2010, the U.S. has spent a tremendous amount of political capital and time to ensure that the outcomes of the September session were reached. Now that the United States' term on the Council is ending, how will the United States ensure that the recommendations of the OHCHR investigation and the resolution are fully implemented? And in addition to that, using Sri Lanka as an example, what would prompt the United States to accept moving Sri Lanka from Agenda Item 4 to Agenda Item 10?
Very good questions. So I should explain, the way the council works is you can run for two consecutive three-year terms, and then you have to set out a year of actually being on the Human Rights Council, one of the 47 members. And so then we are in observer state status this year. But I should also note that, you know, when I see our work at the council, I don't think our membership is the most important thing. I think it's our engagement. That we have countries who, like, say, Egypt, for example, not always constructive, but many people think they are a member of the council, even though they're not and haven't been, because they're so active in their engagement, and they do affect how the council works. You can still run resolutions. You can still do joint statements. You can still do virtually everything. The only thing you can't do is vote, which is an important tool. But it's one tool among a full panoply of tools. And we intend to be fully engaged on our key priorities working with our partners. It's not so much whether or not we have to do something, but we have to lead oftentimes. And if we're in the room leading an effort, then others will join us. On Sri Lanka specifically, we wondered, by the way, it's a little confusing. It's under item two, actually, which is the other piece, the other place where we've run resolutions that are more condemnatory. It sounds like an item four resolution, of course, when you read it, but it is an item two resolution. Item two, it allows you to sort of have tabula rasa. You can kind of make it whatever you want to make it. So we will continue to pursue that, and, you know, I'm regularly in contact with both the Sri Lankan ambassador. Our ambassador there is in contact with all the key players. We are going to continue to make it clear that Sri Lanka has to live up to the commitments it made in the September sessions resolution. Importantly, one of the core commitments they made is that they would have involvement of foreign or Commonwealth judges, prosecutors, and investigators. This was a hotly debated item. We did not define specifically what that inclusion of these foreign folks would look like, but just that they have to have some aspects of it. We wanted to leave them free somewhat to create an accountability mechanism that was doable in the country, but still was credible. And that's the key word, I think. For me, we might be able to, at some point, have a different tack. Already the September resolution looked very differently than the prior resolution. But I think we could take a different approach, whatever item it ultimately falls under. But the key aspect to that is going to be a credible accountability mechanism. And when we assess whether the accountability mechanism is credible, then we're going to look, among other things, to what Zaid, the High Commissioner, says about their accountability mechanism. So they need to work hand in glove, in our estimation, with OHCHR to ensure that the account, because look, at the end of the day, this is a golden opportunity for Sri Lanka's future, because they are not going to be able to have a reconciliation without accountability. And if they don't have reconciliation, then the Muslim community and the Tamil community are continuing to be, they're not going to be able to create a nation. Our principal interest in Sri Lanka is that we want to see stability and security and prosperity. And we think that the sole way to do that, or a precondition to doing that, is having a proper accountability mechanism that's credible.
I think we have time for one or two more questions. So all the way in the back.
Thank you very much. I was wondering if you could speak for a few moments about the council's work on the economic and social rights aspect. Thank you.
You know, we have a interesting relationship, the United States does, with ESC rights. We're not parties to the convention, so we take the legal position that the rights enunciated therein don't apply to us. And we have certain legal ways of looking at, we're probably the most legalistic, I think, delegation in the UN system. And so we oftentimes are sort of isolated in statements that we'll make regarding our legal positioning. We have changed, though, how we address ESC rights. And you'll see over time that we have not blocked consensus as much. We have issued instead explanations of position, for example, so long as we can get certain language changes in the resolution. So we have tried to support resolutions on ESC rights, and we will continue to do so. Some of them are more difficult than others because the sponsors of the resolution don't want to change one aspect or another that could be a legal red line for us. And then once it gets to that point, there's not much we can do other than to be against it. I would just say that we have moved from a position of generally no to a position of yes, but. Meaning, yes, we can agree with this construct, but this is how we look at it. This is how we interpret it. And that has allowed us, I think, to be much more malleable in our negotiation posture with other states. And so we are looking at this, and I think that'll continue, at least in my tenure, it'll continue.
As a closing follow-up, can you, and since there are a lot of students here who are kind of committed to a human rights career or continuing to be engaged in human rights and practitioners, can you say a little bit about how the U.S. does move from the no to the yes, but? Like, what are the efforts that contribute to that? And from the outside, do you have any advice for human rights advocates trying to influence U.S. government positions?
Get into key governmental positions. there were key people that were appointed in this administration that changed that. Harold Coe was absolutely essential in making that move. Michael Posner, who was the Assistant Secretary for DRL, for Democracy, Rights, and Labor. These folks put a lot of energy into saying, look, we shouldn't be saying no to these things. We should explain our position. And they're absolutely right. I mean, one of the things we're trying to do right now is change the conversation on development. We don't agree that there's a right to development, but we should be able to have a constructive conversation about development and human rights. And do they relate to one another, and how do they relate to one another? Because we do believe that certain aspects, rule of law, certain aspects of human rights are critical to having effective development. So we like to have this conversation. But what has happened is we've had it in this context of this right to development that has just gone nowhere. So how do we have it in a more constructive way? I think advocates can be helpful. Look, I mean, I will tell you, for example, right now, the situation in Sudan, as opposed to South Sudan, has deteriorated substantially. But as opposed to, say, a decade ago when Darfur was hitting the front pages, it's not really talked about much. And frankly, I think it's for the sad, sad reason that the Sudanese have so mainstreamed human rights abuses that it's almost like they have to do something even greater and more horrible to get the world's attention. There is a situation right now where the humanitarian crisis is growing, the human rights situation is deteriorating. And so when you see those, when you're in NGOs and you see those things, I think we rely often on civil society to make the case publicly. Because at the end of the day, the actions that we can take at the Security Council, the GA, or at the Human Rights Council are dependent on what the market can bear. And if you start off the conversation with the entire African group of 13 countries being against you, it's really challenging. Because added to those 13 countries are going to be at least 5 countries, now with Ecuador coming on board, 6 countries that, except for Israel, will vote against every country-specific resolution. So you're doing the math, and that starts you off with negative 19. But if we can have the case made, working in conjunction with civil society, then we have much greater prospects, and that's how we are able to, over a year period, build the record and build the case on South Sudan. That's how we were able to take action regarding Burundi. So civil society plays an integral role. And frankly, look, you have an important role in pushing us. We're going to make our own determination, but we make our determinations in light of the discourse that we have with civil society. And so there have been a number of issues that we have altered our views or our position. Now, the State Department is like a aircraft carrier. Even when they know the direction we want to go, it takes us a while to get there. But that conversation is critical. We regularly meet with civil society in Geneva, here, and in all places, because we value those relationships. It's one of the reasons why, more than any other state, we take the position that we don't care if we agree with what you're saying or disagree with what you're saying. We don't care if you're critical of us. We are going to always defend your right to say it at the Human Rights Council.
Great. Well, thank you very much. I want to thank you again, Ambassador, for coming and spending time with us and sharing your views. Thank you very much.
Thank you.